And then it's a pleasure for me to introduce to you our second speaker of today. It's Professor Jacques Duchateau. He's from Université Libre de Libre de Bruxelles. That will be Free University of Brussels. That's about as much French as I do speak. Professor Chateau's work focuses on the control, often in relation to fatigue. He advised me at the time that I did some single motor unit studies myself, and I guess that he will show you some data on single motor unit behavior in relation to rate of force development today. He also knows the importance of the rate of force development from personal experience in sports, because if I remember well, Jacques used to be quite a good athlete. I think a decathlon or a javelin thrower. Yeah, is that good? Yeah. He's a modest person, but I think that was quite a few years ago. This is now. Jacques, thank you very much for accepting our invitation to speak here today, and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Joe, for these very kind words. First, good afternoon to all of you. And first, I would like also to thank Nicola Mafioletti for organizing this symposium and to ask me to give a talk on the neuromuscular determinant of the rate of force development. Well, as already evoked, the rate of force development, or torque development more correctly, is sometimes more important than the maximal force itself. It is not only true during sporting activity, but also during activities of daily life when people, for example, are losing balance, it is important to react very quickly. And the main point is that one takes usually more than 200-300 milliseconds to reach the maximal force, so increase the rate of force development allowed to increase the fraction of force you develop during the contraction, increase the first force impulse, and thus the performance. So today, I will mainly focus on the first part of this relation. So this means that when you reach about 50-60% of your maximal force, because it has been shown by Anderson and Agard in 2006 that the rate of force development is more well correlated with the maximal force when you reach, let's say, a level of force that is close to your maximal force. So I will mainly focus on this part of the force time curve. Well, the determinant of the rate of force development can be located at three different levels. First, at the muscle level, and I will evoke the fiber type composition, muscle potentiation, and muscle temperature. Then I will evoke the transmission of force to the bone by the elastic component, and we will see the stiffness is an important parameter. And then finally, I will evoke the neural activation, so this means the recruitment and the discharge rate of single motor unit. So let's start with the muscle. Well, you all know that despite there is a continuum between the different fiber type, well, many studies subdivided, well, the fiber type into categories. Type 1, which is slow fiber, and type 2, that are fast fiber. And in this study, the Smith and Godot stimulated different muscle with different proportion in fast and slow muscle fiber. And when you compare, for example, the masseter, which contain about 60 to 70% of type 2 fiber, you can see that while the rate of torque development and the peak torque is briefer than the soleus muscle, for example, that contain only 10 to 20% of fast fiber. So certainly, the fiber type composition is an important parameter in the performance in the rate of force development. But of course, here in these studies, the contribution of the elastic component that transmits force to the bone cannot rule out completely. But anyway, animal studies show clearly the muscle fiber type composition is an important parameter. Now, the contribution of post-activation potentiation is also important. Only few studies look at that or speak about this aspect when they are looking at the rate of force development. For example, in this study, we stimulated the dorsiflexor muscle with a single pulse paired stimulation or a train of three stimuli. And you see here the force produced in the dorsiflexor muscle. And it is clear that when you compare the response to two stimuli, well, it's more than two times the contribution of one stimuli. So this means that there is some potentiation, and you can appreciate the level of potentiation by subtracting from the train of two stimuli, so the paired stimulation, the first contribution, so this means the single stimulus contraction, and you can see that, well, the contribution of the second response is much than twice that of the first stimuli. You can do that also for the rate of force development by computing the first derivative of the signal, and you see that the contribution of the second response is much greater than the first one. If you do the same for the third contribution, thus by subtracting the train of three stimulation, by subtracting the train of two stimulation from the train of three stimulation, you see that the contribution of the third response is even greater than the second one, as it is also the case, although the difference is quite low, for the rate of force development. So clearly, post-activation potentiation contribute to increase the rate of force development during deactivation, the onset of deactivation. And it is important to mention that greater effect is observed for fast muscle fiber. The third factor that could affect the rate of force development at the muscle level is muscle temperature. And it has been studied by Jordan Reuter a few years ago in a hand muscle. In fact, they stimulated at, well, different frequency up to 300 Hertz and measured the rate of force development at four different temperatures, ranging from 22 to 37 degrees per centigrade, and then compare the maximal rate of force development for this different temperature. Here is the result. It is the black histogram, and you can see, and as expected, of course, that the maximal rate of force development increase with the increase in muscle temperature. But if we concentrate on physiological temperature, you can see that, well, in fact, the increase in muscle temperature, only 1 degree increase in muscle temperature increase the rate of force development by about 3%. So it is also an important parameter that will determine the rate of force development produced by the muscle. Now let's look at the series elastic component. You all know that, well, the contractile component will produce force that will transmit to the bone by a series elastic component. It was already mentioned by AVL many years ago, and today it is often, we often subdivided the series elastic component into two subgroups. Well, the active fraction, which is mainly located at the cross bridge and the myofilament, and a passive fraction that are mainly located in the aponeurosis and the tendon. And today, thanks to ultrasonography, it is possible to analyze this part of the series elastic component. And it has been done by a study of Bosch and Müller in 2005, where they measure the elongation of the tendon aponeurosis complex during an isometric contraction of the quadriceps. In fact, the subject had to increase the force slowly, and then measure the elongation of this tendon aponeurosis complex. And from this relation here, from this curve, force elongation curve, they measure a stiffness index from the steeper part of these curves. And then they also ask the subject to perform fast contraction and measure the maximal rate of force development during the first 100 milliseconds. And they found a good association, as you see, between this rate of force development and the stiffness of the tendon aponeurosis complex. So this parameter is also important and thus will play a role in the rate of force development. Let's now speak about the neural activation. You certainly all know that the motor unit is the functional unit of the neuromuscular system and is constituted by a motor neuron, the fiber, the axon that prolong this motor neuron, and all the fibers that are innervated by this axon. And when we want to increase the force, we recruit additional motor unit, but at the same time, there is also an increase in the discharge rate. But a main point is that the recruitment, the whole recruitment ended when the force reached about 80 to 90% of most of the muscle, except in hand muscle, when recruitment ended around 50 to 60% of the maximal force. So you have to reach very high force level to recruit all motor unit. However, it is not true when we are speaking about fast contraction. And it was demonstrated by Desmet and Godot many years ago when they asked subjects to increase the force progressively at much higher rate to a similar target. And the last contraction, what they call at that time a ballistic contraction, meaning a contraction that was performed as fast as possible. And they measure the recruitment threshold of motor unit. What that means, in fact, it is the force at which a unit starts to discharge when it reaches a certain level of force. And here is an example of different unit with clearly distinct recruitment threshold, the first unit with a low threshold, a medium threshold, and a high threshold recruitment force. And as you can see, when you increase the mean rate of force development, there is only few difference, only few change when you use very slow contraction. But when you increase the rate of force development, you can see that there is a dramatic decrease in the recruitment threshold of this unit. And this means that even at maximal velocity, maximal rate of force development, you can see that the recruitment threshold is quite similar for all this unit. And so this means that during fast contraction, all motor units are recruited at a low force threshold, and they were able to show that at force of about 30 to 40% of the maximal force, all motor unit of the muscle, it was in the tibialis anterior, were recruited. So this means that it's completely different from a slow contraction. And so this means also that to increase the rate of force development when all these units are already recruited can be done only by increasing the discharge rate, which becomes the important parameter in the acute increase in the rate of force development. So what level of discharge rate can we reach during fast contraction? Again, it was the same study comparing here, two different contractions, a slow ramp contraction, so the force increased very progressively, and in this case, it was a very fast contraction. You can see the difference in the time, about 5 seconds to reach the target torque during the slow contraction, a bit more than 0.1 second to reach the peak torque during the ballistic contraction. And if we look at the same motor unit, you can see that the discharge rate is quite different. One reach about 30 Hertz, so 30 discharge per second for the ramp contraction at peak force, but we reach two times this discharge rate for the ballistic contraction, as you see. So this means that maximal motor unit discharge rate is much greater during ballistic contraction than slow contraction. And we documented this in a more detailed study with Michael van Kutsem in some years ago in the tibialis anterior. The subject performed dorsiflexion very quickly, and we measure single motor unit. You have an example here of one trace with two different motor units. You see the action potential is quite different. A small one discharging four times, a bigger one discharging only two times. What we did was to measure the mean discharge rate for the first three interspikes interval, because most of the unit didn't fire more than four times. And here is the distribution for more than 100 motor unit. And you see clearly that the mean value reach around 70 Hertz, but also some units are discharging at much higher rate and close to 200 Hertz. So the question is now, do we really reach discharge rate that are sufficient to perform the maximal rate of force development, at least the maximal capability of the muscle rate of force development? So to try to reply to this question, we measure contractile contribution of single motor unit with a method that would be too long to explain. It's the method called the spike trigger averaging that has been introduced by Milner, Born, and Stein many years ago. And you can, with this method, record the force produced. Here is an example of two different motor unit. A first one with a long contraction time, and a second one with a shorter contraction time. And the second one also developed more force than the first one. So we measure this for a great number of motor unit and compute the relation between motor unit twitch torque or force and the contraction time, the time to peak torque of this unit. And thus we compute a pool of 200 motor unit, and from this pool we simulated, well, the force produced during a tetanic contraction at different discharge rate. And here is an exam. You see the force time curve for one unit, and we compute the first derivative to get the rate of force development. And here is the result of this simulation study. Here is the rate of force development as a function of the discharge rate for different motor unit. The first one, so the slowest unit of the pool, in fact, and you see clearly that we reached the maximal rate of force development when discharge rate was nearly around 100 Hertz. But in contrast, for the fastest motor unit, we only reached this maximum rate of force development for discharge rate comprised between 300 and 400 Hertz. So it is very high discharge rate. So if we compare untrained subject with the simulation study, we can see that we cannot reach the maximal capability of the muscle. But we did an experiment some years ago where we trained subjects performing ballistic contraction during 12 weeks against load of about 30 to 30% of the maximal force. And we report here for one subject, well, the trace, so the ballistic contraction, you see the torque before and after training with a really a greater increase in the rate of torque development. And we measure also the contractile properties of the unit of this subject, and we saw only modest increase in motor unit time to peak. So that means that the contractile properties did not change that much with these types of contraction, this type of training. But in contrast, what we observe when we recorded the maximal discharge rate of this unit, so here is the distribution in blue before training, and after training, here is the discharge rate, and you see clearly that there is a shift to much higher value. So with training, we increase this discharge rate, and we observe also what we call doublet discharge, that is a discharge of a unit two times at a very brief interspikes interval that corresponded to about 300 to 400 Hz. So thus it seems that with training, you can approach this the maximum rate of force development that a muscle can develop. So the conclusion here is that this observation suggests that the maximum rate of force development is mainly due to the limitation in peak motor unit discharge rate, at least in untrained or not well-trained individuals. And it is, supported by another studies by Joe de Rote, showing also by comparing the rate of force development achieved during voluntary contraction, but also during electrically stimulation, that there is a limitation at the voluntary activations. So to close the last part of my talk, I would like to convince you that discharge rate is really the main important parameter. And I would like to show that we can change the discharge rate as a function of the initial condition. And on the field, of course, we perform movement from very different initial condition that we tend to reproduce in the lab. Of course, we had to perform this contraction in isometric because it is impossible to record single motor unit during fast movement. But we try to compare, well, dorsiflexion performed from different conditions. First, from a resting state, does the subject perform this contraction every 4 or 5 seconds, as you see? So we measure the torque. We measure the first derivative of the torque to get the maximum rate of force development. We measure also surface EMG from the tibialis anterior, which is the main agonist muscle, and also from the soleus, one of the antagonist muscle. In addition, we record single motor unit with intramuscular EMG. This is the first condition, but we compare to another condition that we call static ballistic contractions. In that case, the subject had to increase the force and maintain a force that corresponds to 20-25% of the maximal force, and without any transition to perform a ballistic contraction. And the third condition was to insert between the sustained part of the action and the ballistic contraction a very brief relaxation of the muscle. So the subject relaxed very briefly. You can see that there is no EMG activity during this period in the agonist muscle, but it is not a reversal activity because you can see on the antagonist muscle that there is no increase at that time of EMG activity. In fact, we try to avoid or at least to lower the contribution of the elastic component such as it appeared during the stretch shortening cycle. So when we compare the rate of force development obtained in the three conditions, we were surprised to see that the static ballistic contraction reached a much lower value than the ballistic from a resting state, but not surprised that we reach a much higher value for the voluntary relaxation before the ballistic contraction. And, well, in parallel, we observe exactly the same tendency for the EMG activity. So we compute, we measure the burst of the EMG at the beginning of the contraction itself. But the main point was to analyze the activity of single motor unit, and you have an example here of a single motor unit recruited at the beginning, at the onset of the activation during the ballistic contraction from a resting state, and the same motor unit here in the second condition. So you see that this unit is discharging at a very low rate during the sustained contraction, and the same unit discharge at a much higher rate at the onset of the ballistic contraction. So when we compare many subjects, many motor units from many subjects, well, you can have the tendency that appear in terms of discharge rate. So here is the instantaneous discharge rate during the sustained part of the action. So this unit is discharging at a low rate. And here is the discharge rate during the ballistic part of the action. And you can see clearly that discharge rate is much lower during the static ballistic contraction compared to the ballistic performed from a resting state. So this difference in discharge rate can explain, in part at least, the difference in the rate of force development. And now we compare the static ballistic contraction without any transition, and with the static ballistic contraction when we insert voluntary relaxation before the dynamic aspect of the contraction. And usually, well, the duration of the relaxation was comprised between 150 and 200 milliseconds. And if we add the data that we collected on the previous graph, you can see that we can reach much higher value when you insert this voluntary relaxation before the ballistic action. So clearly, there is a modulation in the discharge rate that is influenced by the initial conditions. So in conclusion, initial condition influence the maximal discharge rate attained by motor unit during ballistic contraction. Please, I hope you are convinced. And together, these results, this observation emphasize the key role played by the nervous system in the maximal rate of force development. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Jacques. The paper is open for discussion. Are there any questions?
Hi, Tom O'Brien from Liverpool John Moores in the Bangor University in the UK. I was just thinking about sort of an experimental protocol. How would you control a brief relaxation prior to the contraction to make sure it is a relaxation and it's not a counter movement, stretch shorten cycle inducing action?
Well, the criterion was that there is no EMG activity in the antagonist muscle during this period. So, well, subjects were trained first. Of course, we had familiarization session, but we control when we measure the traces that there was no EMG activity in the antagonist muscle.
Hi, Jesper Binger from the hospital in Copenhagen. I was thinking about the last part of your presentation here. How would that translate into practical training? Is it that if you want this relaxation period, would that be that you showed the figures from a squatting exercise, for instance, would that be that you perform an eccentric contraction where you kind of relax the muscles and then catch the movement with the flexed knees and then try to do it as concentric contraction as fast as possible?
Well, a small part can be due to that, of course. But as you see, well, nevertheless, we have a big change in the maximal discharge rate. So discharge rate must mainly contribute to the increase in the rate of force development. But we cannot exclude, of course, the contribution of this factor.
Okay, but I'm just not sure how to translate into an actual movement in outside the laboratory.
Oh, outside the laboratory.
Yeah.
Well, of course, we didn't record during, let's say, shortening contraction or eccentric contraction, so that's true. But for me, the most important point is to have a very fast activation. As already underlined, it's important to have, well, the intention to have very high activation and brief activation is important, and thus, after that, of course, well, movement will reach a certain level of velocity because due to the all the forces transmit to the bone, of course, and what is the inertia that you have to move. But at least it's important to have very intense activation, very brief and intense activation. But of course, it is in isometric conditions in this case.
Thank you.
I think you actually did a very good proposal yourself to implement it in practice. I mean, squatting, just let the weight fall and have a relaxation and then counter the falling movement with an upward movement. I mean,
it was just my understanding of it.
Yeah, well, I think it might be a good idea.
Nate Sharabon from Slovenia. So I'm wondering, many studies on rate of force development, especially single fiber, was done on movements like opposition of the finger or abduction of the second finger and dorsal flexion. And can you comment on how, I mean, there are quite big differences between movements one can perform really rapidly, so with a high rate of force development. Quite uncommon for me is, for example, these small movements with the finger or dorsal flexion in comparison with, for example, knee extension. Do you know about the differences in such more familiar tasks for rate of force development against those that are quite uncommon?
I did not understand your question about.
I mean, in some movements, for example, knee flexion is more difficult to develop explosive rate of force development, and similarly, dorsal flexion in comparison to plantar flexion, or small movements of the fingers, in my opinion, are much more difficult than push off with the legs or knee extension and similar. Do you know about potential differences in intramuscular coordination in such different movements?
Well, I accept that the dorsiflexor muscles are not usually used in dynamic contraction. So maybe they are more untrained in comparison to quadriceps, for example, triceps surae. So probably you have more adaptation in muscle like this because they do not perform currently often very dynamic contraction. So you have right. Probably there is more adaptation, but due to this, this muscle are maybe less trained for ballistic contraction. So you have more improvement.
More effect. Thank you.
Last very quick question.
Okay. John Breed from Aspetar in Qatar. Does this relaxation period affect the reliability of RFT measurement?
Well, we at this stage, we didn't look at this reliability. Reliability. We mainly look at when the criteria are reached if we can increase the discharge rate of motor unit. But of course, when people are not familiarized, there is a great variability from trial to trial, of course.
Okay, thank you very much.